Past performance may not be indicative of future results. Therefore, no current or prospective client should assume that the future performance of any specific investment, investment strategy, including the investments and or investment strategies recommended and or purchased by advisor or product made reference to directly or indirectly will be profitable. Different types of investment involve varying degrees of risk, and there can be no assurance that any specific investment will either be suitable or profitable for a client's investment portfolio. No client or prospective client should assume that any information presented serves as the receipt of or substitute for personalized investment advice from the advisor or any other investment professional.
Welcome to the Bullington Capital Report, hosted by Bill Bullington. For the next hour, you'll receive information on current market conditions and trends that could affect your financial future. If you have a question, you can participate in today's program by calling 216-901-0945. That's 216-901-0WHK. You can also reach Bill by going to his website, bullingtoncapital.com. And now, here's Bill Bullington.
Well, welcome back. Seems like it's been a long week. It's mind-boggling. All this stuff going on in the Middle East, and just story after story after story, and you got politics from the United States, and just makes me want to bury my head sometimes. But I can't do that. Got to keep right on top of it. And interesting, the stock market really didn't go down that much with all the bad news that has come upon us all of a sudden. Like, in fact, it ended up just slightly below where it opened at the beginning of the week, which is I thought was really interesting. So, that's one of the reasons that constantly say, and they just don't try to predict the market. You know, you just, no matter how many times you say it, I know people are going to do it. And especially if they haven't been looking at it closely for an extremely long time period, because they start to see things and they think they're onto something and they just don't really know. If you keep doing it as long as I have and you keep your tabs on it as closely as I do, you'll go, yeah, don't pay attention. You know, don't pay attention to the general direction of the market. There used to be a day before computers took over, and this is a long time ago. And I know a lot of my clients that have been with me for a long time go, hey, how come you're not doing that stuff you used to do, you know, 20 years ago? Well, because it doesn't work anymore. And that's another thing. Things change. Markets evolve, and they've evolved dramatically. I don't think it's necessarily all that bad. I just think that the investments that you're going to need to make are probably going to fluctuate a little bit more than you would like them to, based on what kind of return you want to get. And the vast majority of people not knowing will look at the highest performing investment and say, yeah, that's what I want. And when I'll dig into it and show them, okay, we can give you that. But here's what it's done in the past and more than likely probably going to do again in the future. And what do you mean? Well, let's take a look at the S&P 500. Go back to December of 2021. Okay, we're going 2 years ago. Yeah, in October of 2022, it was down 32%, or actually about 27%. Annualized, it was 32%. So, but wait a minute, I thought you said that did really well. It has done well. It depends on the time period you're looking at. If you went and invested in October of 2022, you think you're a genius because you're up about 25%. And see, and by the way, it's the same fund. Yeah. It's frustrating, I'm telling you. And what's really frustrating is that they don't have tools like this, the one I'm using to get those prices, that aren't still really expensive. You can get a lot of free stuff, and it's basically, it's worth slightly more than you paid for it, but the free data is there just to kind of lure you in, because everybody's got a data package that you can subscribe to get the kind of data that you're really going to need. And that's not cheap. So anyway, then this package, I think I only pay $50 a month for it, but it just gives me price data on funds, ETF stocks going back, I don't know, probably 30 or 40 years. And I think it's pretty cheap, you know, for what they're doing. $52 a month for that. And I can scan markets for looking for certain characteristics. Now, that's another whole animal. We're not going to get into that on today's program because you got to learn a little bit about coding, and it's a nightmare if you're not really into investing and have some pretty decent technology skills. I wouldn't call my skills advanced, but it's a lot more advanced than what most people are doing with their investments. So having said that, like I said, nothing ever stays the same. It's always changing, and keeping up with that is kind of difficult. One of the reasons I'm really fond of a lot of the new investments, you know, companies, insurance companies, brokerage firms, mutual fund companies, companies that make products, investment type products or financial products, they're constantly watching the markets evolve. They're constantly watching demographics, how they shift, you know, ages, incomes, that sort of thing. And they're creating products all the time that they think would be useful for the general public, or at least some segment of the general public. They're creating products for that. So it really benefits both parties. It benefits the people who can take advantage of those products, and it benefits the companies that offer those products because they can go into business and make a decent profit. And that's what the stock market's all about. All those companies in the stock market are there because they're they're designed to try to make profit. Profit's not a bad word. I want my company. The companies that I'm investing in, if they're not making money, they're not making profits, I'm not investing in them. What kind of nut does that? I'll tell you what kind of nut. No, I won't. Let's just forget that. But so you want your companies profitable. And that's one of the things back when I used to have to do this all by hand. Okay. I used to, I still had tools that I could do screening for. So it was mostly by hand. I would backtest various models. You know, let me give you an example of what that might be. I want all stocks that pay dividends that have raised their dividend each year for the past 5 years. Boom. It runs that screen and pulls out all the stocks from the Russell 3000, effectively the United States stock market, that have raised their profits for 5 years, the last 5 years. And then you can go a step further than that and say, okay, now I want those that have paid dividends, whose dividend increases has kept up with the, have also raised, doesn't have to necessarily be by the exact dollar amount, but they've also raised their dividends each year for the last 5 years. And boom, it gives you another, every stock that survived that screening tool shows up on that list. And that's actually done now several different ways. And you can slice and dice that as finely as you would like. You can add other features to it, take some features away, whatever. This is America. You're free to do whatever you'd like to do, as long as you're not hurting anybody. And, you can narrow that down and you get your list. And that's basically how I used to run all the money. Now, I wasn't the only one that was thinking that way. In fact, there are unbelievable how many. There are thousands of funds now that are doing something that's similar to that. They're back testing a model. A lot of it's based on logic. Some of them are not very good at all, by the way. You have to be careful about that, too. But if it seems to make sense logically, companies who grow their sales and grow their maintain profit margins and increase their dividends, yeah, that's pretty good. By the way, that's incredibly difficult to do. Those screens or factors, whatever you want to call them, it makes it really tough to qualify for that. So you're getting kind of the creme de la creme of growth companies that pay dividends when you do that. So, and that's 2 to 3 of the funds that I'm holding in the portfolios that I'm managing do that. That's what they're looking for. And and it's important. And you can see that over long time periods, yeah, that makes sense. If sales are rising, if they're maintaining their profit margin, if they're paying a dividend, they're able to increase the dividend, hey, that's pretty good. Yeah, it is really, it's actually really good. And there aren't that many companies that can qualify to do that. So I want to make sure that I have some of that in my portfolio. And now there are some other ones that I really like as well. And we'll go into those on a future show. I don't want to spend the whole first segment just talking about mathematical models. But if you have questions on that, or if you'd like to talk to me about it, you can always go to my website, and I'll try to get back to you as quickly as I possibly can. And it's bullingtoncapital.com. There's a contact us page. And, yeah, we can talk about how we might construct the model. And you know what? These days, we can actually do them specifically for you now. Something that we just started. You decide what kind of stocks that you want to have in your portfolio. We'll talk about it together and what makes most sense. I will add my my 2 cents for whatever experience I've gained over the last 30 years and share that with you as well. And it generally works out pretty good. Yeah, I really like it. When hard times are coming, that, yeah, we've seen this before. We'll probably see it again at some point in time. And here's how you make it through. And a large part of that, by the way, is based on your tolerance for risk, as it should be. And you have a conversation about that. What kind of risk taker do you really think you are? And that conversation, that's a 10 or 15 minutes, sometimes an hour, sometimes several weeks. It depends on how many times you've ever thought about the amount of risk you're taking in your portfolios. And that's a big deal. A lot of people don't. After all these years, 30 years, people still don't have any idea of what kind of risk that they're taking in their portfolio. And I'm like, wow, I literally thought I would have been out of a job by now. But at this rate, it'll probably be going long after I'm gone. And for people that don't want to take much risk at all, which, you know, the older you get, typically you don't want to be taking a ton of risk. And some young people don't want to take any risk. So again, there's no right or wrong answer here. There's just whatever makes you feel good. So if you don't want to take a lot of risk, there are a lot of funds out there, or they're called annuities. Fixed indexed annuities are my favorite. There are tons of different types of annuities, incidentally. And depending on your age, depending on what you are trying to achieve, are you trying to maximize income for yourself, which is fine? Are you worried about leaving money for your beneficiaries? If you have them, that's fine. Are you worried about keeping your income if something happens and you happen to have to go into a nursing home for any length of time? Because those are super expensive, and you don't qualify for Medicaid unless you're practically broke. So there's a lot of questions to try to be answered there. And this is basically what retirement planning is all about. And I just started a whole new course series on retirement planning. It's been updated for all the changes that have been made over the past 5 years. Yeah. By the way, everything changes in financial services. Typically about 10 to 15% a year. If you added all the rules together and then looked at everything that was changing, it averages about 10 to 15%. So after 5 or 6 years, there's been a substantial amount of change. It's pretty mind-boggling. But keeping up with it is kind of important. Going back and just say, hey, Bill, let's review this. Am I still okay? And pull out the notes I had from our conversation, figure out where you wanted to be, where you are now, and is that still within the guidelines that you kind of came up with together? And if so, then hey, no problem. If not, then here's are some changes you might want to make, and that's basically how it's done. So you can sleep at night. Yeah, and that's kind of a good feeling, being able to know that, you know, I'm doing all that I can, and yeah, so I can get a better night's rest. But at any rate, a lot of the products, by the way, are not simple, and that's the part that I feel worst about for the average person that's coming up on retirement, or even the young people. I mean, if you're below the age of 40, or if you're above the age of 30, there is so much stuff that you have to know, and it's going to take you several years to become conversant with it. I mean, even if you do this for a living, it's going to take you several years. And but if you're really sharp and you're on, you know, maybe you got a job as a lead programmer, a software engineer, means you're probably really pretty good at math. There's still a lot of stuff that you have to know that's not math. You know, it affects the math that you're going to have to know, but it's not really math. Well, what am I talking about? Well, co-pays and deductibles. That it's mathematical, but you've got to figure out where those fees fall in. How are you going to pay it? How are those funded? You know, there's health savings accounts now to help people do that. And the health savings accounts, I think there was 1,500 pages last time I looked in the Internal Revenue Code covering that. I'm like, really? That's the I'm not a big fan of big government. Let me put it that way. If you want to take something that should be 10 pages and turn it into 1,500, send it to Congress. That's exactly what will happen. But anyway, I guess I shouldn't complain too much. It just it does keep me working really hard. There is no time to be bored in my position, because you've always got stuff to do. And I've just been told I've got about 60 seconds before I got to take a commercial break. So this is Bill Bullington. If you want to have a conversation with me, go to my website and reach out there. There's a contact us form. I'll try to give you a call back as quick as I can. And I did get a couple in the last couple of days, from last week's show, that I will be reaching out on Monday. And so now I'm going to go to commercial break, and I will be right back.
Christ is my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand.
My first ride-along was with Jamal, even before I was hired. They wanted me to see everything from the ground level before moving forward, and it was awesome. The first time I came in, I got to sit in on a meeting and never realized that plumbers have that level of organization and sophistication to their operations. And I say that as a former degreed project manager, as well as an Air Force vet. After getting out of the service, my wife and I moved to Cleveland, and I just wasn't happy with the corporate-style desk jobs. So I prayed for a sign. That next morning, my best friend called me about this radio ad on The Fish for a company he thought would be perfect for me. And he was right. Wyatt Works was a godsend. You have to want to help people. But if you do, this job is fulfilling in ways that the right person won't find anywhere else. If you want that for your life, call us direct and
consider it done at WyattWorks.com. License number 30185.
Wallacadoodle.
From an idea that started in 1967, Our Lady of the Wayside has grown to serve almost 900 children and adults with developmental disabilities throughout Northeast Ohio. It's an operation that is still growing thanks to tremendous support and generous donations like the Wayside's car donation program. You can donate your ride to the Wayside for a great tax write-off by calling 1-800-368-6262. The Wayside is also looking for people to join their team. They hire for attitude and train for skills. Visit thewayside.org to apply today.
Do you ever find yourself saying, I need a vacation? Vacation Fixation can help. At Vacation Fixation, we specialize in all-inclusive trips and cruises to Mexico, the Caribbean, and Disney vacations. Why choose us? Our clients book through Vacation Fixation because they are frustrated with online trip brokers and timeshare scams. Whether it's a weekend getaway, a family trip, spring break, or honeymoon, Vacation Fixation will personalize a trip just for you. Want to know the hottest destinations in Cancun, Punta Cana, Jamaica, or Puerto Vallarta? Interested in room upgrades, beach reviews, or details about resort restaurants? How about finding a trip with a direct flight? At Vacation Fixation, we take all of your specific travel requests and shop our suppliers to find the best deal. What's the cost? Our suppliers pay us so you don't have to. Call 330-573-8147 for more details. Or you can visit our website at vacationfixation.com or check out the deal of the day on Facebook, Vacation Fixation.
Is it finally time to update your bathroom? Bath Planet, a division of Joyce Factory Direct, specializes in replacing and converting old showers and tubs into new beautiful bathrooms in as little as one day. We have transformed thousands of bathrooms just like yours into a spa-like oasis that has homeowners excited to use their new bathtub or shower. Right now, all bath installations are 50% off. So call to schedule a free consultation with on-the-spot pricing. 440-243-5700 or visit JoyceFactoryDirect.com.
You. Well, welcome back. I've got a caller on the line, and John must have a question for me.
Good morning,
John.
Bill.
Are you there?
For the holidays.
How are you?
It looks like a temporary hiring for Walmart and the seasonal hiring may be easier this now than the COVID time. Secondly, I don't know whether they'll be raising another 0.25% federal. The thing that bothers me more than anything else is, since 1980, I've been watching hearings and Federal Reserve and Senate hearing and everything. Why hedge funds with no purpose and no mission statement are allowed to get through, and then nobody can even do due diligence? This latest one is, but I don't want to think it's the Republican Democrat. President Trump said, you know, buying the merger type of thing, the whole thing has fallen off. I'm not crypto. And the whole thing is, hedge funds are buying all the houses, convert them to Airbnb type of thing. So forget about the interest rate for the mortgage. Somewhere along the way, when I watch the hearings, either they're deaf or they're blind or they're looking the other way. And
right.
It's bad because banking and insurance are the pillars of capitalism. And both, I would like them not to be winners and losers by picking. I want them to free hand. I'm all for some regulation has to be there. But then everybody, you know, somebody boxes in the hand, and it's sad when I watch the hearings. I get a little bit disappointed, although I'm an eternal optimist. I'm just sitting here with the cataract surgery after 88. I'm still listening to you every day.
Wow. Congratulations on that.
It's okay. But, you know, why can't we, again, I've told this many times, we don't teach capitalism to the high school kids and anybody else, congressmen, senators, half of them don't understand what's going on. They look the other way.
Yeah.
But with all that, thank God we are doing whatever we can to keep this place running.
Yeah. No, it's actually, I think the grand experiment they talked about in history. Yeah, they were talking about more politically, but, you know, the United States is the only country that teaches economics as a standalone
science.
That is
right. It's the dollar is the currency of the world, and I don't care what China or Japan was supposed to be dead a long time back. And it's an experiment, which I'm, you know, there's not much time left, but I think I'm lucky I'm not in a wheelchair in a nursing home. I still keep track of things.
Yes.
I do surveys.
Right.
It listen to you regularly. But I still believe.
I hope I have half the brain that you have when I reach your age.
I told the doctor, I get the injection every 6 weeks. I told the doctors, man, God is great. He's fair. He gave menopause for men. Women, prostate for men, but since Sears went out of business and the CEO got all the distribution of the money after bankruptcy, that's why I don't have extended warranty on parts and labor.
Yep.
That's
all right. Well, hey, John, thanks for calling. And thanks for listening.
Keep up the good work. Keep on educating people.
I'll try. All right, you have a good weekend. Bye-bye. And if you'd like to call in, the phone number is 216-901-0945, 216-901-0945. You know, I was just thinking about this morning. In some ways, and in a lot of ways, my job has gotten a lot easier. But I would not want to have to be doing it all over again. There is just so much to know anymore. It's mind-boggling. I mean, then being able to understand what you're reading is one thing. Being able to determine whether or not it's bogus or not is another thing. And it's always changing. There are always new rules coming out, and it's just mind-boggling. It can be overwhelming when you get to that point in your life where you're trying to make plans for retirement planning, which incidentally, you should probably be starting right around the age of 12. Now, next week, I'll tell you why you should start that young and why you should start teaching that. And I think that's pretty much, I read the biography, authorized biography on Warren Buffett. I can't remember what the title of the book was. I think it was like 800 pages. Anyway, this guy wrote the book, and Warren Buffett supposedly started his investing account at the age of 12. And he was using money that he had gotten from paper routes. And at the age of 12, he went and took on a ton of paper routes by himself, and then he hired other kids to deliver the papers for him. So he was definitely ahead of the curve. And somebody was asking him if they could do what he did again. And I think that's what his answer was. Well, if they start at the age of 12, you know, but he's not the richest man in the world. He just won in the top 10, I'm pretty sure. I stopped tracking that stuff a long time ago, especially when Amazon came out and Jeff Bezos just blew past everybody. And I think Elon Musk might be pretty close. So between those two. But bottom line is, you'd better start a business, and it's got to be a really, really good business, like electric cars or like Amazon, the world's biggest online retailer. Got to be big if you're going to be up in that group. And I don't know. I think there's a little bit. Well, there's a lot of luck involved, but there's also skill and intelligence and grit. But bottom line is, those people started their own businesses really young too. That's what they all have in common, I think. Maybe not Jeff Bezos. I think he was just more of an academic. Anyway, I'm digressing. When you start getting close to retirement age, when should you start looking at this? Again, you should start looking when you're, you know, when you're pretty young. If you're in your 40s or 50s, you just have to realize 30, 20, and you're going to, I would try to save as much as you possibly could. People, they want an exact number. Well, it can't really give you an exact number. I mean, I could, but it would just be a guess. And when I'm doing the math, if you look at any sort of inflation rate, like 4 or 5%, you should start saving somewhere around 20% of your paycheck, you know, not your net after taxes, but your gross, and that is incredibly difficult to do today's market. So what happens is a lot of people, even like myself, you know, I had a bunch of kids before I even knew anything about any of this. So I'm like, uh-oh. But you have to, it takes an enormous amount of money to be able to lead a normal lifestyle. Let's take an example. Let's say you're going to spend 5% a year, 5% of your investments, or 4%. I'll stick to the 4% rule. You're going to stick to 4%. For every $40,000 you want to have in retirement, you got to have $1 million. Yes, I know. When you don't do the math that often, or you haven't thought about it, it's pretty shocking. That's one of the reasons that these annuities are so important, because it can cut down on the money that you have to save by about 25% or so. That's a big cut. So instead of having to have $1 million, now you only need 750,000. Well, it saved you from having to save an extra 250,000. That's a big deal. By the way, Social Security will end up making up a pretty good chunk of almost everybody's retirement. The people that are not helped a lot by Social Security are less than 3% of the population. Think about that for a second. Less than 3% of the population is like, okay, I really don't need my Social Security. So I hope that makes you feel better, because it is a big, important part. And every time I hear them talk about, well, we need to cut Social Security. Yeah, you want to see an all-new Congress and an all-new Senate and a new president? Cut Social Security. I dare you. They bring that out just to scare people to try to get whatever bill they want passed. And I just can't imagine them. I could see them freezing it, which would have the same effect, by the way. It just works slower. If you froze Social Security and didn't cut it, and you know the cost of living is going up, so the amount that they're paying out relative to the amount of taxes that they're taking in is shrinking, okay? And that works too. So if you froze it, but that's not good enough for this, our current Congress and Senate. They want to scare everybody every time. And I'm not sure what the I am sure, so that they can sneak through some other crap. While everybody's panicking over losing their Social Security, but and you're never going to lose it. By the way, you will never lose it. When they started that program, the funding for it was zero. They started this, and by the way, it was started during the Great Depression. So wait a minute. Let me get this straight. Everything's going to hell in a handbasket, and you want to start a big government program to pay out a bunch of money to people who are too old to work? And yeah, so see, my point here is that Social Security has always faced very long odds of being successful. And except that somebody figured out that, you know, you can actually raise taxes a little bit and pay for that stuff, you know, and you can borrow money too. So it's been going on, and we are nowhere near in as bad a shape as we were when we started the program. It's not even close. So is it going to be comfortable? It's never comfortable. You know, paying off debt is not comfortable. Going into debt, not comfortable. You know, so if you're looking for comfortable, you know, that's probably in the next life. Most things in life are not that comfortable. And you want to make sure you do as much as you can, really. Try to make your life as comfortable as possible, especially on the financial side. Financial worries, I'm absolutely convinced. I don't know what the statistics are. I'll have to look them up for next week's show. But financial problems, I'm sure, contribute to a lot of major ailment, especially in people who are getting older. So how do you protect yourself against that? Well, that's where those guaranteed income programs come in, because they're able to offer a guaranteed income that's a couple percentage points higher than what you can get in CDs or treasuries most of the time. And not always, but the vast majority of the time, those companies that offer those programs are competitive. And they're competing with CDs from banks. They're competing with treasuries from the United States Treasury. And they've got to go out and earn the money to be able to pay those higher interest rates. And they're rated, by the way. They're all insurance companies. You have to have insurance licenses to be in that business, mostly, I should say. And so the insurance companies come up with these products, and they call them annuities. And a lot of the pensions are just fancy annuities. They've got more options than a lot of fixed annuities do. But the fixed annuity generally makes up for that by giving a slightly higher return, generally. And again, if you want more information on that, feel free. You can go to my website, bullingtoncapital.com. We can send you some links. You can set up a phone meeting if you'd like. and we can talk about what that might look like for you. I think that today it just makes so much sense. And for years, you know, I didn't really do a whole lot of business in this area. And now I'd say it's probably about 20-25% of my whole practice is just looking at this, because the guarantees that a lot of the insurance companies are willing to make out there are higher than what you're going to be able to. Most people will not make as much in their stock account, incidentally, as the guaranteed rates. They won't make as much as the guaranteed rates on these insurance products. And so that's why I started using them. When they raised the guaranteed level to a point where I'm going, oh, wow, that's, you know what? They're doing better than a lot of people, not all people, but than a lot of people do in their stock account. They're guaranteeing a return that's higher than the average person gets in their stock account, at least through my experience. And, wow, okay, that caught my attention. And I have it myself. Now I don't have to worry about that. It can allow you, incidentally, if you know you have that money locked away. By the way, the guarantees are only as good as the insurance companies backing them up. Insurance companies have, they've got to report to state agencies. There's a National Association of Insurance Companies. If you want to be a member of it, you have to meet certain criteria. So they just want to make sure that the money is as safe as it can be, and because it's not a government-guaranteed product. So they're scrutinized pretty heavily. Bottom line, and I just lost my whole train of thought there. But anyway, with that type of a product and forming a base, you know, get your base, your basic expenses covered. I like that strategy a lot. So between your Social Security pension and fixed indexed annuities, you just want your base expenses covered. The normally you get cost of living increases in pensions, not all of them, but oftentimes, you know, if you're a PERS or STRS, you're a teacher or policeman, you're going to get an increase coming from the from your pension, just a cost of living increase. And so that's good, because the vast majority of the annuities are fixed. They're not going to go up. So you've got to keep some money back in some other investments that may grow faster to be able to keep up with inflation. And I got about 10 or 15 seconds before I got to take a commercial break. So this is Bill Bullington here every Saturday morning, 11 to noon on 1420. Stay tuned. We'll be right back after these commercial messages.
So you catch me when I fall, right?
You've heard the saying, all good things come to an end. Well, not always. Sometimes they just take a break. That's what's happening with Our Lady of the Wayside's car donation program after 24 years and 96,000 rides donated. Pretty amazing. Here's the story. The car lot's owner has sold the property, making it impossible for car donations to be accepted at this time. According to the Wayside CEO, Terry Davis, the next right steps will be determined and communicated soon, so stay tuned. In the meantime, Terry and the entire team at the Wayside thank you for your continued support of the 450 individuals with developmental disabilities in the Wayside's care. And please take note, you can still support them by making a donation at thewayside.org.
My first ride-along was with Jamal, even before I was hired. They wanted me to see everything from the ground level before moving forward. And it was awesome. The first time I came in, I got to sit in on a meeting and never realized that plumbers have that level of organization and sophistication to their operations. And I say that as a former degreed project manager as well as an Air Force vet. After getting out of the service, my wife and I moved to Cleveland, and I just wasn't happy with the corporate style desk jobs. So I prayed for a sign. That next morning, my best friend called me about this radio ad on The Fish for a company he thought would be perfect for me. And he was right. Wyatt Works was a godsend. You have to want to help people.
But if you do, this job is fulfilling in ways that the right person won't find anywhere else. If you want that for your life, call us direct and
consider it done at WyattWorks.com. License number 30185.
Wallacadoodle. No doubt about it, we're spending more time at home, which is the perfect time to make it more functional and beautiful. Hi, Ed Flash Ferentz here for Artistic Renovations, Northeast Ohio's premier and award-winning remodeler. Artistic did a fantastic job with our kitchen in 2016, and last year, they were back for the master bath. Oh, my word. Do yourself a favor and go to ArtisticReno.com. Believe me, you'll love their ideas and without question, the finished product. For a virtual consultation, call 216-520-0838 or visit ArtisticReno.com.
Thinking about updating your home? Well, Joyce Factory Direct specializes in replacing old, outdated windows. Proudly made right here in Cleveland, Joyce Windows features their exclusive Smart Shield high-performance glass, which means you'll be getting the most energy-efficient windows for your home directly from the factory. Customers just love how much warmer their house is and how easy their new windows operate and clean. Right now, you can save 50% on all installations. Just call to schedule a free consultation with on-the-spot pricing, 440-243-5700, or visit JoyceFactoryDirect.com.
Come set your rule and reign in our hearts again.
Well, welcome back. This is Bill Bullington. I'm here every morning from Saturday. Yeah, I wish. I'm here every morning, Saturday, 11 to noon. You can go to bullingtoncapital.com to reach out and contact us if you want to have a conversation about investment or retirement planning. And you know what? I'm actually, I sign up for these courses. I've probably done this, I don't know, probably multiple times during my career. This time, I guarantee I'm going to finish. It's going to take a while, but I really like it. I mean, the stuff in our industry changes a lot, and it's changed so much since the last time I took one of these courses that I decided to go ahead and even expand that. So over the next few months, I'll be studying more than I usually do. Which is kind of a lot to begin with, but it's pretty fascinating. And we're going into just about every facet of retirement planning. It's kind of what I've always kind of talked about. Down deep, it's where I brought almost every conversation. How much money do you think you need to be able to retire at some point in time? What's the best way to invest to get you there? That's basically what you need. And in a nutshell, trying to estimate expenses, which is incredibly difficult to do if you're in your 40s, by the way. You just have to do the best you can. And when you do, when you start putting a 4 or a 5% inflation rate on whatever you may need to accumulate, by the way, those are the numbers I've always used, 4 and 5%, even though they've been a lot lower than that in the most recent past. But when I grew up, it was in the 70s and the 80s. Yeah, I was just a kid. That was 18 and 81. So just a kid in the 70s when we saw some amazing inflation. And it calmed down and it got a lot lower. The 90s, the early 2000s, it got a lot lower. I mean, the prices were doubling. I remember my father building houses. He was a carpenter and a subcontractor. He used to do all the carpentry work on building some homes. And I remember listening to the adults talk about how much the houses were selling for and how much they'd gone up by. And so I grew up watching that going, wow, that's amazing. So when I got to school, I decided, yeah, I think I'd like to take an economics class to try to figure out to see how do people navigate through that type of environment, what causes it, all that other kind of stuff. And then you find out that the problem of inflation has been around since just about the beginning of time, and it's very difficult to make plans for 40 years from now, but it doesn't mean you just throw your hands up in the air. It's easier to plan over shorter time periods. That's why if you're above the age of 40, it's a little simpler, believe it or not, to do a financial plan than it is when you're in your 20s and 30s because there's so much more unknown time that you have to make assumptions for. Okay. So I know this is probably boring everybody to death, but anyway, yeah, that's me, boring. But anyway, I like the investing part, and that is that's not boring. I mean, you want to talk about you're looking for excitement? just take a look at the stock market. Take a look at how it acts, how it behaves. Try and predict that stuff. Yeah, good luck. And that's one of the biggest challenges. You've got a bunch of things that you're facing. Maybe you need a certain amount of income. You've heard that the stock market's averaged whatever you've heard over the years, and it may be true, it may not, but the long-term average is somewhere between 9 and 10% a year. That's the long-term, super long-term average. But there are 10-year time periods where the returns were negative, literally negative returns. And during those time periods, the market was down more than 50%. So if you were taking money out of those accounts to supplement your retirement income, you may end up having to go back to work in your 80s. Okay? And that's what we want to stay away from. And that's why those annuities that some of my long-term listeners that had complained about, because I wasn't talking about stocks, just stocks, well, that's why. Because if you talk about just stocks, you can't avoid the big declines. You're going to have to find a way to navigate through it, and you're going to be down. And the only thing you can do is bring in other asset classes. You can do short-term bonds. Okay, that's not very exciting. There's not really that much even to talk about in short-term bonds. Longer-term bonds, stay away from that. Stay away from long-term bonds. Intermediate-term bonds, not that safe. I'm looking at the total bond market index. You know, these are intermediate-term bonds, bonds that are like 7 to 10 years in average maturity. Well, they peaked, the bond funds that invest that way peaked in 2020, and they're down about 23-24% over that time period. That was 3 years ago. Those bond funds peaked. They're down 20%. Now, they've been paying some income, but not enough to offset the decline. And those are the high-quality bonds. So you have to be super careful. The fund that I use has an average maturity. Right now, it's about a year. When I first bought it, it was about 2.5 years, so it was staying in super short-term stuff. And if you reinvest your dividend on that, it's got a decent profit in it. And they're both bond funds. And to the average investor who doesn't read the prospectus, they get the highlights and go, oh, yeah, let's take the other BND's got a higher dividend than the FLDR. But I think I'm going to take that one. The reason that the dividend was higher is the same reason that it's down 30%. Okay? They don't tell you about the risk. They expect you to know what the risk is. They just tell you what they're doing, not what the potential risks are. And that bothers me. I think they should actually have to explain that in a prospectus. I mean, they do it for everything else. Well, why wouldn't you do it for that? And now, anybody that's listening out there that might be a regulator, you're with the SEC or whatever, yeah, bring that up to your boss. You should have to. I don't think you should be allowed to invest in a fund unless you can pass a test. What would happen if interest rates were to go up by 2 or 3% to this fund? What would be the most likely objective? Yeah, now the fund itself would say, well, we're going to try to make the adjustment. Okay, well, then say that. You're going to try to adjust. Because these funds that they have today have a strategy, and they're not allowed to change the strategy unless they go and take a vote from all the shareholders that have invested in that fund. And they can do it. It's just that they won't be able to do it quick enough to react, to respond. And even then, this is kind of an anomaly, the fact that that fund has been as steady as it has, and it's still been volatile. It just hasn't been anywhere near as volatile as the average fund has been. And if you stayed in it and reinvested your dividends, done fairly well, very well, compared to most bond funds. And anyway. bottom line is we put a lot of our money into individual bond funds or bond funds because they're supposed to be more reliable. And they fluctuate too. And quite honestly, they don't fluctuate as much as stocks do. But they fluctuate a lot. And you've got to know something about that to be able to invest in those things safely. See? Now, if you want to invest, anybody can invest. But to invest safely is a big deal. And that's, again, that's one of the things I like about the fixed indexed products, because they give you a schedule. Okay. Here is what you can take out of your account at this date. Okay. And you can, once you do that, you can do that until you die. Okay. And if you do die, if you've got a good product, it has a refund feature or benefit, where the money that's left in there will go to your beneficiaries. In the old days, whenever you took an income, you didn't have nearly as many options as you have today. In the old days, you would take an income, and it would probably be a pretty good income that you could get, probably higher than what you get in CDs or banks. But when you passed away, the insurance company kept the rest of the money if there was any money in there. Glad those products are not very abundant these days. They don't work that way. Well, there still are some that work that way, but there are options. Other options that don't work that way. So you don't have to, you know, disinherit your benefit, your kids, because you want to have a guaranteed income. That's a big deal. I can have an income, and something happens to me, this is going to go to my beneficiary. That's a really big deal. And again, there are literally thousands of products out there. And it drives me nuts. I mean, When you've been doing it for a long time, it's pretty easy to go right to the areas in the prospectuses. They don't even call them prospectuses, but you get a sample contract. You can go right to the areas in the sample contracts to look for the things that you're looking for. It does take a lot of effort, though. It's, thank goodness, I guess. It's very aggravating for me. It's very time consuming, but my job, you know. So, and quite frankly, I don't mind when I think about it in those terms. I like my job, and it's kind of cool. It's never boring, because I'm telling you, this stuff changes like a clock will. And I can't believe I've come all the way up to nearly the end of my show. Only got about 60 seconds here, so I will tell you, if you've heard anything that you would like to discuss, send me an email. It's bill@bullingtoncapital.com. If you want me to give you a call, just give me your phone number. I'll try to get you on my calendar quickly as I can. And I really appreciate everybody listening. And thanks for the nice comments from last week's show. Don't know why that happened, but I'm just kidding. I appreciate it very much. And anyway, this is Bill Bullington. I'm here every Saturday morning from 11 to noon. By the way, WHK has really boosted the equipment is that gets the radio signal out there. I was able to pick it up very clearly for a long distance, much longer than I ever had. So that's nice, too. You might be able to pick it up. And you can pick it up online as well. Just go to iHeart and type in WHK. But with that, I'm going to let you go. Have a good week, everybody. Good luck. Good investing.
You just caught another edition of the Bullington Capital Report, broadcasting every Saturday at 11 a.m. on AM 1420, The Answer. If you have a question and you'd like to speak to Bill personally, you can call him at 330-664-0700. That's 330-664-0700. Or online at bullingtoncapital.com. That's bullingtoncapital.com.
The preceding program has been paid for by Bullington Capital Management, LLC.